we were discussing the Newtonian relativity and the classical Newtonian relativity and the electromagnetism. In fact, in previous two lectures, we have seen that the Newtonian relativity is in fact not consistent with the laws of electromagnetism. In fact, we have found that the speed of light c is an invariant in accordance with the Maxwell's electromagnetic theory. This speed of light c in free space is actually independent of the state of motion of the source and the observer, and Maxwell's theory is based upon this fact. But according to Galilean transformation, the speed of light in free space depends on the state of motion of the observer. We have obtained the result that this speed of light c actually lies between c minus v and c plus v. It means the minimum value of speed of light in free space relative to a moving inertial frame is c minus v, and its maximum value is c plus v, where actually this c plus where the v is actually the speed of the moving inertial frame. So you can say that Maxwell's electromagnetic theory is contrary to the result of the Newtonian relativity, because we have seen that according to this theory, a speed of light c in free space is actually independent of the state of motion of the source and observer. But according to classical principle of relativity, this c is not invariant. So we have concluded that the laws of electromagnetism are not actually invariant under Galilean transformation or Newtonian relativity. We have also seen that laws of classical mechanics are although invariant under Galilean transformation. Now today we are going to in continuation to test one of the most important results which we have actually obtained from Maxwell's field equations, and we have to test the invariance of that very important equation. Actually, while dealing with the Maxwell's field equation in previous lecture, we have obtained the equation of wave equation of the electromagnetic wave, and you have seen the differential equation which actually represents an electromagnetic wave. The wave equation which was obtained from Maxwell's theory was of this form. This is in fact written in a scalar form: del square psi minus 1 over c square del 2 psi by del t square equal to 0. This is actually the scalar wave equation which is resulted from Maxwell's equation. In fact, when we solve Maxwell's equation, then instead of this psi, we have either electric field vector E or the magnetic field vector H. Actually, this wave equation has been obtained in a frame, let us say an inertial frame S, which was actually the frame of ether, and that frame was considered at absolute rest. So this is the wave equation del square psi minus 1 over c square del 2 psi by del t square equal to 0, obtained from the Maxwell's theory. And now in today's lecture, our aim is to discuss the invariance of this wave equation which has been defined in this equation A under Galilean transformation. It means we have to know that the form of this equation A will remain same in a moving inertial frame, or it will not remain same in the moving inertial frame. You will see after discussion that actually the form of this wave equation does not remain same in a moving inertial frame. So after this conclusion, we can say that the Maxwell's field equations are not consistent with Galilean transformations. So now let us see how we can transform this equation A, which has been obtained from Maxwell's equation, in a moving inertial frame, let us say S prime. For this, I have assumed here that two inertial frames, S is an inertial frame and S prime is also an inertial frame. This frame S prime is moving with a constant velocity v in the along the common x direction, and let us take a point P where an event takes place, and this event is described by the observer of frame S as x, y, z, t, and the same event in frame S prime is described by x prime, y prime, z prime and t prime in frame S prime. Now you know that what is the Galilean transformation in this condition. So first of all, I am writing here the Galilean transformation, and after that we will check the wave equation which I have defined in equation A is either invariant under Galilean transformation or it is not invariant under the Galilean transformation. So the Galilean transformations are Galilean transformations are. You have already studied the Galilean transformation, so I am writing here it directly. You have seen that x prime equal to x minus vt. Let us say this is A. Y prime equal to y, z prime equal to z, and t prime equal to t. This is B, C and D. Let us say this is equation 1. These are actually the Galilean transformation equations which we have already obtained in the previous lecture. Now our aim is to test the invariance of the classical wave equation defined in equation A under this Galilean transformation. And so first of all, we rewrite the wave equation in Cartesian coordinate. You know, in Cartesian coordinate, this operator del square, which is called Laplacian, this is defined as del 2 by del x square plus del 2 by del y square plus del 2 by del z square. So the wave equation defined in equation A can be written as, so equation A is written as, how we can write this equation A? You can see the equation is del square psi. So instead of del square, we will write this form, and the wave equation will become del 2 psi by del x square plus del 2 psi by del y square plus del 2 psi by del z square minus 1 over c square del 2 psi by del t square, and this equal to 0. Let us say this is equation B. As you can see, that Galilean transformation actually relates the space and time coordinates in two inertial frames, that is we can relate x prime with x, y, z and t. Similarly, y prime, z prime, t prime in terms of x, y, z and t. But in this wave equation, you find the different the partial derivatives, or you can say the partial derivative operators, that is del 2 by del x square, del 2 by del y square, del 2 by del z square and del 2 by del t square. So actually, to transform this equation in frame S prime, first of all we will have to transform the differential operators like del 2 by del x square, del 2 by del y square and so on. So for this we will follow a mathematical step to transform these differential operators, and you can see, since psi is a function of x, y, z and t, and we have to transform this equation in a frame in which the coordinates are x prime, y prime, z prime and t prime. So let us assume that this psi actually depends on also on x prime, y prime, z prime and t prime. So let psi is equal to psi of x prime, y prime, z prime and t prime. Now let us take the partial derivative of this psi with respect to x. Therefore, you can write del psi by del x. As you are seeing here that psi is a function of four independent variables, not only of one independent variable. So to find the derivative, we must follow the rules of partial differentiation. So according to the rule of partial differentiation, what we can write? We can write that this is del psi by del x prime into del x prime by del x. While differentiating with respect to x prime, we keep y prime, z prime and t prime as constant. So again, the second term will be del psi by del y prime into del y prime by del x plus del psi by del z prime into del z prime by del x and plus del psi by del t prime into del t prime by del x. Now let us make the use of the Galilean transformation which I have defined here. You can see these are the Galilean transformation, and we will make the use of these equations in this equation. So you can see that this is del psi by del x prime into del del x, and now you can see what is this x prime. From Galilean transformation you can see that this x prime is actually equal to x minus vt. So actually we will substitute x minus vt at the place of x prime. So this is x minus vt and plus del psi by del y prime into this much. Now you can see that this y prime is equal to y. So this y prime is not x dependent. In other words, you can say that y prime is not an explicit function of x. And if y prime is not an explicit function of x in accordance with the Galilean transformation, what will be this derivative del y prime by del x? Since y prime does not depend on x, so definitely this derivative will be 0. So this is in fact 0. Similarly, you can see that Z prime is equal to Z in accordance with the Galilean transformation. So Z prime is also not a function of X, and so this del Z prime by del X will be also zero. So you can write this is del psi by del Z prime into zero, and plus you can write the last term, this is del psi by del t prime, and this del x by del t prime, but t prime is actually equal to t according to the Galilean transformation. You can see here this t prime is equal to t, so we can write it simply as this is del t by del x, del t by del x. And now you can see what will be our result. This is del psi by del x prime, and when we will differentiate this x minus vt with respect to x partially, then we will treat this t as a constant factor, and so this will be actually simply del x by del x, because this del t by del x will be zero, and the other two terms are in fact zero, and plus this is del psi by del t prime. Now what will be this del t by del x? In fact, you can see the transformation equation that this will be simply equal to, or if you write in fact t prime, then this will be equal to in fact 1 over v. From this equation you can see this will be equal to 1 over v. And so you can see here that this equation will be written as, since this is equal to 1, and so this equation may be written as del del x prime plus 1 over v del del t prime psi. So what you are seeing here, you can see that we have obtained the result del psi by del x is equal to this much. Since the function psi in both sides are same, so definitely the operator del del x must be equal to this operator del del x prime plus 1 over v del del t prime. So from here we can obtain that the operator del del x is equal to del del x prime plus 1 over v del del t prime. So we have transformed the partial differential operator del del x into the moving frame. Now you can see your wave equation. In fact, in our wave equation, the operator is del 2 by del x square. So now let us find what will be the transformation equation for the operator del 2 by del x square. So you can see from here that this del 2 by del x square, actually this is del del x del del x, and so we can write this as, substituting this value, this will be del del x prime plus 1 over v del del t prime, and again del del x prime plus 1 over v del del t prime. Now you can simplify this. Actually, what will be this? When we will operate this operator on this, although both are operators, this will be del 2 by del x prime square plus. When we will operate this on this, what will be this? This will be 1 over v del 2 by del x prime del t prime. And plus, now we will operate this on this, and the result will be 1 over v del 2 by del t prime del x prime. And finally, we will operate this 1 over v del t prime on this. So this will be actually equal to what? I am writing it here. This will be plus 1 over v square del 2 by del t prime square. Now you know, since x prime and t prime are independent variables, so the order of differentiation does not matter. And so you can say that del 2 by del x prime del t prime and del 2 by del t prime del x prime both are actually same. So you can simply add these two, and therefore we will get that this del 2 by del x square, this is equal to del 2 by del x prime square plus 1 over v square del 2 by del t prime square plus, and these two terms will be combined, and this will be 2 over v del 2 by del t prime del x prime, or you can write del x prime del t prime. So you can see we have obtained the transformation equation for the operator del 2 by del x square. Now we will also find the transformation equation for del 2 by del y square, del 2 by del z square, and del 2 by del t square. So you can see these transformation equations. As according to Galilean transformation, you can see that this y is actually equal to y prime. So if y is equal to y prime, then definitely del y will be equal to del y prime. And similarly, you can see that del 2 by del y square will be simply equal to del 2 by del y prime square. And in the similar manner, you can write the partial derivative operator of second order for z prime and t prime. And similarly, we can see that del 2 by del z square, this will be equal to del 2 by del z prime square, and del 2 by del t square, this will be actually equal to del 2 by del t prime square. So we have obtained all the transformation equations for the second order partial derivative operators. Now we will substitute all these values in the wave equation which we have defined actually here. You can see in Cartesian coordinate I have written the wave equation in this equation 2. So now let us substitute all those transformation equations for the operators in this equation 2. So substituting these in equation 2. You can see what will be actually our wave equation. The equation 2 says del 2 by del x square psi, and del 2 by del x square is actually this much, which we have obtained here. So instead of del 2 by del x square, we will substitute this much. So this will be del 2 by del x prime square plus 1 over v square del 2 by del t prime square plus 2 over v del 2 by del x prime del t prime, and this is operated on psi. But the second and third term will remain same, because you can see that del 2 by del y square is equal to del 2 by del y prime square, del 2 by del z square is equal to this much, and del 2 del t square is equal to this much. So they actually remain same. So you can see that the next term will be del 2 psi by del y square plus del 2 psi by del z square, and plus, not plus, but minus. You can see there is in fact a minus sign in the last term. So this will be in fact minus 1 over c square del 2 psi by del t prime square. Del t prime square. Now you can also write del y prime, because the transformation equation says that del 2 by del y square is equal to del 2 by del y prime square. So I am writing here the prime sign here. So this is now the wave equation when we transform it in the frame S prime. So you can say that this is wave equation in frame S prime, which is actually a moving inertial frame. So now let us simplify this equation to some extent. You can see this equation may be written as del 2 psi by del x prime square. Del 2 psi by del x prime square. Now let us write first of all these two terms. So this will be del 2 psi by del y prime square plus del 2 psi by del z prime square, and then the other terms will be what? That will be plus 1 over v square del 2 psi by del t prime square plus 2 over v del 2 psi by del x prime del t prime, and minus 1 over c square del 2 psi by del t prime square, and this equal to 0. So in frame S prime, when we have obtained the same classical wave equation which was defined in frame S, then we get this result. Now you can see, in fact, the sum of these first three terms can be written in terms of the Laplacian operator. If we assume that the Laplacian in frame S prime is written as del prime square, then you can simplify this equation in this manner. So we can write it as del prime square psi, del prime square psi plus 1 over v square del 2 psi by del t prime square plus 2 over v del 2 psi by del x prime del t prime and minus 1 over c square del 2 psi by del t prime square, and this equal to 0. Let us say this is equation B. Actually, this is the classical wave equation in frame S. We have obtained the wave equation in frame not S, but the moving inertial frame S prime. Now you can see the form of this classical wave equation, which has been defined in equation A and in equation 2, in equation B. So I am writing here again. So in frame S, what is the wave equation? You can see this is del 2 psi minus 1 over c square del 2 psi by del t square, and this equal to 0. So now let us compare these two equations. What are you finding here? You can see the form of this wave equation does not remain same in frame S prime, because these two terms are extra terms. If the wave equation obtained were del prime square psi minus 1 over c square del 2 psi by del t prime square equal to 0, then only we can say that the form of wave equation remains same. But due to the presence of these two terms, we can say that the mathematical form of this classical wave equation does not remain preserved after the transformation of the frame. It means the wave equation actually changed when we transform from the inertial frame S to S prime. So from this we can say that this wave equation is not invariant under Galilean transformation. So comparing A and B, we find that the classical wave equation does not remain invariant under Galilean transformation, So now we can conclude that any law of electromagnetism will not remain invariant under Galilean transformation, because you have seen two examples, and from those two examples it has been established that the laws of electromagnetism are not consistent with Galilean transformation, or you can say Newtonian relativity. So our final conclusion is that laws of electromagnetism or electrodynamics are not invariant under Galilean transformation. But you have seen that the laws of classical mechanics were invariant under Galilean transformation. So definitely there is a dot that either the Galilean transformation is correct or the laws of electrodynamics or Maxwell's theory is correct. So regarding this, actually there will be three possibility. We can think three possible things regarding this. So final conclusion is what? Conclusion, you can say the final conclusion is laws of electromagnetism are not invariant under Galilean transformation. It means you can say that the Newtonian relativity principle works well for classical, for the laws of classical mechanics, but it badly fails when we consider the laws of electromagnetism. So what are our possibility in this situation? So now let us discuss what will be the possibilities. First of all, we will see what are possible in this condition, and then we will see actually which possibility is in fact possible. So first of all, you can say that like Newtonian mechanics, the correct electromagnetic theory must be invariant under Galilean transformation. But since it is not, so Maxwell's equations, which form the basis of electrodynamic theory, are not correct and must be modified. This can be think that since laws of classical mechanics are invariant under Galilean transformation, but the laws of electrodynamics are not invariant under Galilean transformation. So one can think that Maxwell's theory is faulty, Maxwell's equations are incorrect, and so this theory must be modified. This may be the first possibility or first thinking of ourselves. So the first thinking will be Maxwell's equations, which form the basis of classical electrodynamics, classical electrodynamics are not correct and they must be modified. This may be the first possibility. One can think, since laws of classical mechanics are invariant under Galilean transformation, but we have seen that the laws of electrodynamics are not invariant under this transformation. So one can think that Maxwell's equations are not in fact correct and they need to be modified. This is our first possibility. The second possibility, you can say that the Galilean transformation is applicable to mechanics, but there is a preferred unique inertial frame in which Maxwell's equations are valid. Actually, this preferred unique frame is Ether's frame. In other reference frame, if we want to apply this equation, then it must be suitably modified. So you can say that Galilean transformation is in fact all right for the classical mechanics, but if we want to apply it for the laws of electrodynamics, we must assume a preferred inertial frame. So the second possibility is the Galilean transformation. Galilean transformation is applicable to mechanics. When you say mechanics, it means classical mechanics or Newtonian mechanics, but there is a preferred frame. A frame of a specific importance is called preferred frame, or frame means inertial frame, in which Maxwell's equations are valid. And if we want to apply these equations in other frame, they must be modified. So in other reference frames, they must be suitably modified. So this is the second possibility one can think, that Maxwell's equations are valid only in a preferred unique inertial frame. And if we want to apply or write these equations in any other frame, then this must be modified. So this is the second possibility one can think. Now we look what will be the third possibility. Actually, this third possibility is just contrary to the first possibility, that in this case we consider that Maxwell's equations are valid, they are correct, there is no fault in Maxwell's equation, but there is a transformation under which the laws of electrodynamics as well as those of classical mechanics are invariant, but those transformation equations are not Galilean transformation. And so this simply implies that Newtonian laws are not correct. So you can say that the third possibility is Maxwell's equations are all right, and Newton's laws are not correct. And there is a need of such a transformation equation under which the Maxwell equation as well as the Newton's laws should be invariant. There should be a transformation under which when you say both of these, what does it mean? It means Maxwell's equations as well as Newton's laws of motion. So under which both of these are invariant. So these are the three possibility one can think when the laws of electromagnetism are not consistent with Galilean transformation. Now let us examine which possibility is actually possible. We can see, in fact, if we consider the first possibility, that you can say if the first possibility were correct, then we must be able to perform an experiment to show that Maxwell's equations of electrodynamics are not correct. But in fact, all experiments which have been performed till now so that the Maxwell's equations are successful, they are not correct. So you can say no experiment defy Maxwell's equations. Maxwell's equations. Simply you can say that till now it has been found that Maxwell's equations are experimentally correct. So what we have said in the first possibility, that Maxwell's equations are incorrect, so we cannot say that Maxwell's equations are incorrect, because you know, when we talk about the correctness of any theory, then we prefer the experimental result. So if experiment says that Maxwell's equations are correct, so definitely we cannot say that Maxwell's equations are incorrect. So no experiment defy Maxwell's equations. So possibility one is not correct. When you say possibility one is not correct, then what are you telling about actually? Actually, you are telling that Maxwell's equations are not correct, and Maxwell's equations are correct, but we have assumed in the first possibility that Maxwell's equations are not correct and they should be modified. So according to the experimental result, there is no need to modify Maxwell's equations, because Maxwell's equations are all right on the experimental basis. So we defy the first possibility. Now let us see what has been told in the second possibility. Actually, in the second possibility, there have been assumed a preferred frame or privileged frame in which Maxwell's theory is correct. But if the second alternative is accepted, we should be able to locate the privileged or the preferred frame experimentally. And this privileged frame in question is the classical ether frame. The space is believed to be filled with a medium called ether, through which the waves are supposed to propagate with a constant velocity, which is equal to c, and c is 3×10⁸ meter per second, and actually in which Maxwell's equations are valid. But this privileged observer is one of the one at rest relative to the ether. But the idea of this preferred frame has been rooted out, has been completely rooted out by the result of the famous experiment, which is called Michelson-Morley experiment. In fact, after Michelson-Morley experiment, it has been established that there is no preferred frame. So in the second possibility, as you have assumed that there should be a privileged frame in which Maxwell's equations are correct, and if we want to write these equations in other frames, they should be modified. But after the Michelson-Morley experiment, it has been established that there is no preferred frame. So second possibility is also not correct. So there is no preferred frame. And this conclusion has been drawn after the famous experiment माइकेलसन मोरले एक्सपेरिमेंट, माइकेलसन मोरले एक्सपेरिमेंट। सो आफ्टर माइकेलसन मोरले एक्सपेरिमेंट इट हैज बीन एस्टेब्लिश्ड दैट देयर इज नो प्रेफर्ड फ्रेम एंड सो आवर सेकेंड पॉसिबिलिटी इज ऑल्सो नॉट करेक्ट। इनफैक्ट वी विल लर्न अबाउट दिस फेमस एक्सपेरिमेंट आफ्टर दिस लेक्चर। वी हैव नॉट स्टडीड माइकेलसन मोरले एक्सपेरिमेंट टिल नाउ, बट यू विल सी इन द नेक्स्ट लेक्चर माइकेलसन मोरले एक्सपेरिमेंट एंड देयर यू विल सी दैट द फ्रेम विच हैज बीन ट्रीटेड एज ए प्रेफर्ड फ्रेम एंड ईथर हैज बीन एस्यूम्ड एट एब्सोल्यूट रेस्ट एंड नेम्ड प्रेफर्ड फ्रेम इज एक्चुअली ए हाइपोथेसिस। ईथर इज नॉट ए फिजिकल रियलिटी। So our second possibility is also not correct. So if the first and second possibility is not correct, then definitely we can say that our third possibility is correct. And what is the third possibility? In third possibility, we have assumed that Maxwell's equations are valid and Newton's laws of motion are not valid. So this is actually correct. So there is a need of a transformation equation in which the laws of classical mechanics and the laws of electrodynamics both are consistent, both are invariant. Actually, such transformation equations are known as Lorentz transformation, which we will discuss in further lecture, and you will see under Lorentz transformation the laws of classical mechanics and the laws of electrodynamics both are invariant. In other words, you can say under these transformation you will find that the laws of any branch of physics are invariant. So Maxwell's equations are not incorrect. In fact, Newton's laws are incorrect, and there is a need of a transformation equation under which the laws of classical mechanics and the laws of electrodynamics both are invariant. So finally we conclude that Maxwell's equations are correct. Newton's laws are not correct at all times, but it is limited. These are limited. In fact, you have seen in the introduction that Newton's laws are correct only when we consider the motion at low speed. So if we want to write these laws at higher speed, then these laws need a modification. So Maxwell's equations are correct and Newton's laws are not correct at all times. These are limited. And there should be a transformation under which laws of electrodynamics as well as classical mechanics, or you can say Newtonian mechanics, classical mechanics are invariant. And as I have told you, such transformation equations are known as Lorentz transformation, which we will study in the further lectures. Transformations. So finally, till now we have discussed actually two things. We have found that the laws of classical mechanics are consistent or invariant under the Galilean transformation, and laws of electromagnetism are not consistent or not invariant under Galilean transformation. And so in this regard, finally we have concluded that there should be another transformation equation. In fact, Galilean transformation equation is faulty. It will be valid only at low speed, when we will talk about the speed which is much larger, comparable to the speed of light c, then there should be another set of transformation equation. And such transformation equations are actually known as Lorentz transformation equation. And we will see under these Lorentz transformation equations actually the laws of classical mechanics along with the laws of electrodynamics will be invariant. So actually this is the drawback of Galilean transformation or classical relativity, that it is applicable to the laws of Newtonian mechanics, but these are not applicable for the laws of all branches of physics like electrodynamics.